Hello, and welcome to the 9th annual Sisters of IHM Foundation celebration event to support our elderly and retired IHM sisters. My name is Sister Ann Monica Bubser, and I am the Executive Director of the Sisters of IHM Foundation. Thank you for joining us this evening. We are so happy that you could be with us. Tonight we celebrate our IHM sisters, our mission, and ministries. We will be talking about the good work of our sisters and how your help and support for our retired sisters is so important to us. This year, we are honoring four special individuals for their commitment and wonderful work on behalf of the Sisters of IHM Foundation. You will meet them and our honorary chair, Pat Brier, a little later in our show. I would like to begin tonight's program by introducing the president of the IHM congregation, Sister Catherine Claus.
A very warm welcome to each of you who are joining us this evening. How grateful we are for your presence and your support. Each year at the IHM Foundation event, we recognize persons who embody our IHM spirit and mission and keep it alive in their daily lives. Tonight, we celebrate and offer congratulations to our Spirit of IHM Award recipients. They are four remarkable and committed colleagues in mission: Nada Gilmartin, Michael McGrath, Tim McMullen, and John Murray. Nada, Michael, Tim, and John have been integral members of the Foundation Board for the past 9 years. Each one of them has shared their love and appreciation for the congregation. Their expertise and gifts, and their creativity in their work with the board, in their service to the congregation through their board membership. They have become our partners in furthering the mission through celebrations like tonight. Congratulations, Nada, Michael, Tim, and John, and thank you. Tonight, you will hear from a number of our sisters who will share with you how they live the mission through their ministries. We are grateful to the IHM Foundation for affording the sisters this opportunity to share their ministry experiences with us. Additionally, we are grateful for all who have been part of the planning and preparations for tonight's celebration, especially attorney Pat Brier, a former student and longtime friend of IHM Sisters. Pat serves as this year's honorary chairperson for our event, and he assists the development office in their efforts to achieve their goals. Thank you, Pat, for your work with us. We are very grateful. Now, on behalf of the congregation, I would like to offer our deep gratitude to Sister Ann Monica and her staff for their generous and their ongoing work on behalf of the congregation through the development office. Thank you, Sister Ann Monica and staff. We are very, very grateful. As we continue our evening tonight, let's take a moment to hold in our hearts all those persons who are in need of God's tender and loving care. Let us remember our donors whose generosity assist the congregations in the care of our retired sisters. And let us remember our retired sisters whose lives inspire us and whose prayer furthers the life of the congregation. Generous God, your unconditional and spacious love for all models for us how you are calling us to love and care for others. Energize us with your spirit so that we can follow you with fidelity and passion. We ask you with full faith and confidence. Amen. Again, thank you for your presence and your support. We are very grateful.
Thank you, Sister Katie. Tonight, we would like to tell you a little about the works of our IHM sisters, and you will meet a few of us. I'd like to introduce you to a friend of mine, Sister Miriam Pfeiffer. Sister Miriam serves as a prayer minister, and she resides at Our Lady of Peace residence
which is our home for elderly and infirm sisters. Sister has been in music education and music therapy ministry for 55 years. Her most current mission was serving at Marywood University here in Scranton, where Sister initiated the music therapy program.
Thank you, Sister Ann. I'm so happy to be with you here tonight. I truly enjoy my years of ministry in music education, the classroom, and music therapy. All of our sisters have sought to meet the needs of God's people, especially marginalized people, with the love of God deep in our hearts. We continue to carry the good news of his unconditional love to all.
You are correct, Sister. And all IHM carry God's love into our ministry. But those we support here tonight are the sisters who are in prayer ministry at Our Lady of Peace residence.
I'm so excited to be part of tonight's celebration, honoring four founding members of the Sisters of IHM Foundation who work so hard on behalf of our retired sisters.
Thank you, Sister Miriam. Our program tonight features the stories of remarkable sisters and extraordinary individuals whose lives and actions embody our IHM spirit. Our four honorees are wonderful examples of individuals who have given their time, talent, and support to our congregation. Nada Gilmartin, Michael McGrath, Timothy McMullen, and John Murray are charter members of the Sisters of IHM Foundation. We are so happy to be featuring them tonight.
It is with great pleasure that I introduce our honorary chair, Attorney Patrick J. Brier. Hi, Pat.
Hi, I'm Pat Brier. I am thrilled to have been asked to be the chair of this year's fundraising event for the IHM Foundation. My history with the IHMs is a lot like a lot of the honorees for tonight. We go back many, many decades. I'm one of seven sons, and we grew up just a few blocks away from St. Paul's School in Greenridge, and all of us attended St. Paul's and with the IHM sisters. I also had the benefit, of course, of knowing the Bubsers and Sister Ann for a long, long time, and then attending Marywood. So I go back a long way at the IHMs. I diverted for a little while and went to Scranton Prep, and then did work with the Jesuit Volunteer Corps. So the Jesuits and the IHMs in my heart, in my life, have played a gigantic role. And in the event tonight, this is really about paying back to people who have really been just the ultimate backbone in my world for social justice and for the church, and they are the IHMs. And so I'm just thrilled to be here and thrilled to have been asked.
Thank you, thank you. So Pat, on behalf of the IHM Sisters and the Sisters of IHM Foundation, we recognize you as an honorary chairperson for the commitment and cherished values and mission of the IHM Sisters, so that you are an example of what we believe in. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you very much, Sister Ann. And I'd like to dedicate this to my mother and my mother-in-law, both Marywood grads and IHM alums. So thanks so much. And congratulations, everybody.
Thanks, Pat. Our next segment, we hear from our wonderful Sister Frances Rose Lapatino, also known as Sister Franny. Sister Franny lives at the IHM Center and works with us in the development office. Sister Franny is a gifted communicator and is always a cheerful presence. She is perfectly suited for her other assignment, volunteering with Telespon. Sister Franny ministers to our elderly and ailing sisters who are living at Our Lady of Peace residence. She is always a bright spot in someone's day. Hi, Sister Franny.
Thank you, Sister Ann. I'm happy to be part of tonight's celebration. The IHM sisters are very grateful for the opportunity to serve God in our ministries. We have been blessed with our vocations through our special callings in education, healthcare, parish ministries, and spiritual development. We have given joyfully and have been blessed with so much. The IHM congregation has a proud history of serving others for over 175 years. Here is just a snapshot of some of our friends in the community and in their ministries. I wish to thank all of our friends and supporters. We are so grateful for everything you do for us. Now I'd like to introduce you to one of our many talented sisters, Sister Cor Immaculatum Heffernan, IHM. Sister Cor is a very talented artist and retreat director. Hi, Sister Cor.
Thank you, Sister Fran. Good evening. My name is Sister Cor Immaculatum Heffernan, and I am so happy to join with you this evening and to share with you. I've been an IHM sister, vowed sister, for the past 64 or 5 years. Actually, it's longer than that. It's closer to 67 years. And it's been a wonderful, wonderful life. And so I'd like to share some of that with you. My ministry throughout my religious life has been education, initial and ongoing spiritual formation, retreat work, spiritual direction, especially with priests and seminarians, and art. My love, of course, is sculpture. And I really have been so happy since I moved into Our Lady of Peace residence last August to the wing that is the independent wing on the fourth floor. And my happiness is there because while I am working with our sisters and enjoying their company, I am also able to continue the work that I do with spiritual direction and retreats and my art. It's a very beautiful experience that I have been having. Anyone who walks through the front door of Our Lady of Peace residence is greeted by a sculpture of Mary, Woman of the Eucharist. And her very presence welcomes anyone who comes in with peace and joy and Eucharistic love. Here also, the sisters are being fed spiritually, physically, emotionally, and intellectually. We love being together. One of the things we've always known about IHM sisters is their joy in one another, the joyful, loving service. And that is found here. We love to celebrate feast days, birthdays, national holidays. We love to share stories of past ministries and events in our history. And that adds to the physical, spiritual, emotional well-being. But perhaps the most important thing here is that this is a home where the sisters really have such a powerful, powerful influence. They are really a powerhouse of prayer. And their prayer extends very, very specially to you because of your interest and love for the IHM sisters. And so we want to say a very sincere, prayerful thank you to each one of you. And may God continue to bless you and your families. Thank you so much. And now I have the opportunity to introduce Sister Elise King, one of our outstanding teachers and researchers, who is presently the coordinator of our English as a Second Language program, a very important program of the IHM Sisters. Sister Elise.
Thank you, Sister Cor, and hello to everyone watching. I'm so happy to be part of tonight's Sisters of IHM Foundation celebration. My name is Sister Elise King, and I'm the coordinator for our congregation's English as a Second Language program. We are a totally volunteer program, Located in the youth center of St. Stanislaus Polish National Cathedral Church in South Scranton, our program is free to our students. After the COVID shutdown, we reopened for in-person instruction in October with 7 IHM sisters and 5 lay teachers. This past academic year, we served 54 students from 16 countries who speak 6 languages. Our program is unlike traditional education programs. By nature, immigrants lead migratory lives. They struggle to find work, and when they succeed, they work long hours at very hard jobs. Our students are adults with numerous personal and family problems. Yet they come to class when they can, because they know how important it is to learn English if they are to succeed in the United States. We IHM sisters are called to be with those who are poor, struggling to live and provide for their families on the margins of our society. Our ESL program answers this call. We are blessed to be able to bring God's unconditional love to our struggling immigrant brothers and sisters. I would like to ask you to consider helping one of our brother or sister immigrants learn English. We are always in need of volunteers. If you want more information, any IHM sister can give you my contact information. Thank you to everyone with us tonight and to all our supporters. It is your generosity that makes it possible for us to help those who live on the margins of society to develop the language and culture that will help them to become productive, contributing members of our local communities. Thank you. Now I'd like you to meet another fantastic IHM sister and friend of ours, Sister Kathleen Lunsman. Sister Kathleen is the president of a national organization called SOAR. SOAR stands for Support Our Aging Religious. Sister Kathleen's ministry is located in Washington, D.C. Hi, Sister Kathleen.
Thank you, Sister Elise. I'm Sister Kathleen Lunsman, and I have been an IHM sister for nearly 35 years. In those years, I have worked in organizations in places like Wilmington, Delaware, Carbondale, Pennsylvania, New York City, Scranton, Pennsylvania, and now Washington, D.C. I work for an organization called SOAR, Support Our Aging Religious. SOAR helps congregations of women or men religious care for their aging members by providing funding for equipment or projects that make the lives of aging religious a little bit more comfortable. We provide grants for Catholic sisters all across the country, including our very own IHM sisters. I worked in the development office of our congregation for a number of years, and I know firsthand the impact of your donations. Your generosity, your financial contributions truly make a difference, especially for our aging sisters. I hope you have enjoyed learning a little bit more about some of our sisters and our ministries. I'm grateful to be part of this special event. Thank you for your prayers and your friendship, your generosity, and your support of the IHM sisters. Thank you.
Now it is time to meet the very special honorees of this evening's event. Lori Cadden will be talking to and interviewing our honorees. These outstanding individuals were selected in recognition of their commitment to and embodiment of the IHM spirit and mission. Each honoree has served us since the foundation was formed 9 years ago. Lori?
Joining us today are John Murray, Nada Gilmartin, Tim McMullen, and Michael McGrath. John, how did you get to know the sisters?
Well, let's see, it started at St. Joseph's Children and Maternity Hospital, now known as St. Joseph's Center, where I was put up for adoption in the great year of 1956. Made my way to St. Paul's School for 8 years, down to Bishop Hannon for another 4, and a short stint at Lackawanna, and I went to Marywood and graduated from Marywood in 79. So I have a long history with the sisters.
And Nada?
Well, if the pictures tell the truth, it probably was at a Marywood Children's Day with my mother. Oh, I don't know, 30, 40 years ago. But then, of course, at chapel school with Sister La Salette, my first grade teacher, and on through to St. John's, and then Our Lady of Peace. I I didn't get thrown out of these places. It was by choice. And then Marywood Seminary and Marywood College, now University. So it's been a long and good run.
Tim, how did you get to know about the Sisters?
My affiliation with the Sisters started at least 100 years ago. My great aunt was the first class to graduate from St. Paul's School, and my mother was the first class to graduate from St. Clair School, both IHM educated, and then continued on with the several generations of family members that attended St. Paul's, including my children and myself.
And Michael, how about you?
I came to a little bit later than everybody else. Not having grown up here and gone to school here, I didn't get the same exposure when I was younger, but my wife, her aunt is Sister Adrienne Barrett, and I think that's where really my first true involvement came from with the Sisters is through Sister Adrienne.
And Tim, 9 years ago, mm-hmm. you were called as a group to help the Sisters. What was your reason for jumping in saying, I'm going to do this?
John wanted to have a keg party. So. No, the reason was just to give back. It's a chance for me to say thank you to the Sisters for the years of education that I received from them, including the extended family of mine as well. So I think anytime you have an opportunity to say thank you to someone who's helped you in life, you take advantage of that opportunity.
And Nada, what about you when you were called by, I assume, Mr. Murray?
Yes, and of course, when your friend asks you to do something, you think, well, I like him, he's pretty much fun, this'll be good, of course I'll help. But my hook was a little bit different. That was going to be a garden party under a tent with white dinner jackets, so he's a good salesman. But but all kidding aside, I think when we all began to think about this, we realized what a debt of gratitude we owe to the Sisters. And when you start to think about it, you just, the effect they've had on all our lives, and you hear their voices and telling you what to do in a situation you might be in. And I think we all really just wanted to be a part of this, and as Tim said, say thank you.
And Michael, when you got the call, what did you think about that?
Well, it wasn't a call. If I recall correctly, I think it was over beers that it might have begun. But we were discussing going to a fundraiser for another organization, shall we say. And when I asked John if he was going to be going, he said, no, I have something else in mind. And I asked him, and he explained to me what it was. And when I heard it, I immediately said, I'm in. I'm all in. Let me know when, let me know how, let me know what we need to do. It took a couple years in true John Murray fashion, but we eventually got there. And, you know, it's one of those things that when you learn about it, and like I did coming a little bit later into it, so to speak, you learn about what the Sisters have done, and you know, they give so much and ask so very little. And so it's an easy sell, so to speak. It's an easy sell to look at and say, yeah, I'm all in on it. Anything you need, anything you want, anything you need. So that's how I came to it.
John, this is going to be a two-part question for you. Since you're the one who's pulled everyone together all these years, 9 years ago, what was your reason for doing it? And then tell us how you think the foundation has changed over the 9 years that you've been involved.
Okay, well, it started out at my kitchen table. My daughter Megan came home one night. She was working for Life Geisinger at the Our Lady of Peace Center. And she was telling me about the Sisters and the Sisters that would come into to Life Geisinger and whatever they did there. But she said, you know, a lot of them don't have families, a lot of them don't have like some of the extra things that maybe they could use. And I said, well, why don't we have a party? And that's all. It started out as one single party. I said, well, we'll have a party. We'll see if we can raise like $15,000 or $20,000. And we'll go from there and see if we can buy the Sisters some nice things that, you know, they wouldn't otherwise be able to afford or think about buying. And that's how that all started. And then I called these guys, as you know, and the other one I talked to was actually in the parking lot of Wegmans. I yelled across the across a few cars to Timmy Linehan and said, "Hey, Tim, we're going to have a fundraiser for the IHM Sisters. I'm in." And I said, "Okay." It wasn't a hard sell for anybody. And then Maggie Quinn Mariotti, she was our other original board member. So I had we had all that. Then we got together, and it started out. The reason, as Michael said, it took a little while because we couldn't just have a party. We had to form a foundation. And so I went to Sister Teresa O'Rourke and said, you know, told her what we'd like to do, and then the leadership changed, and then we ended up finally getting all the foundation stuff together. So it took about a year by the time the Department of State got around to giving us all of our paperwork. And also, we decided to have a party. We had it down at the university, and it was great. PJ Carlissimo came in, and it was very well attended. And Joe Quinn and Monsignor Quinn and PJ played off one another very well, and it was a fun night. And we ended up raising a lot more than the $20,000 we had originally planned on raising, and we're probably closing in on $1 million now after 9 years. So, yeah, it worked out from the little keg party, as Timmy said, in Maloney Woods, which is what I was more familiar with than some. But anyway.
And so the changes are, how do you view the changes in the foundation?
It really just the money grew. I mean, the people are still the same people, and they're still the same mission, and they still have the same love for the sisters, and they still do what they, what needs to be done. It was just that the money grew. And then actually when the pandemic hit and we went online, the money grew even more. So it seemed to be doing pretty well for what we do. And I think the sisters are happy. We throw them a nice little party every year on their feast day in December. And, it's just good. It's a feel-good organization.
And now that John touched on it, the COVID situation and how everything was changed, the fundraising and where you're at today and continue to be. I know the change was probably a little, what do we do and how do we make it happen? And as John said, it's still so hugely successful. What did you feel about all of that?
Well, I think COVID was really maybe a wake-up call. I think those of us who fundraise for other organizations as well realized that people really did want to help. People reached deep in their pockets. They wanted to make sure organizations survived. It certainly divided people, but it also brought people together. And I think that's what happened here. And it was fun coming up with the video presentation and, you know, just adapting to what was what we had to do that year. And I do think people really responded because they felt these were desperate times, and maybe did even a little more than they had to. But it was fun. I had people saying, "I just called my friend and I said, you have to watch this video, it's great." And it was really for people who'd never done this before. Everybody got it together.
And Tim and Michael, you can add to this. We all know that the pandemic has changed the way we do so many things. But as Nada just alluded to, the fact that you're having this event on Zoom or however it's presented, and people can actually go in and see this or go back and see it from all parts of the world for however they want to look at it. How does that make you feel that through all this and all these changes, now you have this tool that's so powerful, especially in the fundraising world, and to be able to promote the mission of the sisters? Either one, jump in on your thoughts there.
Go ahead.
No,
I think one of the biggest factors is the fact you make more money. Your costs have been substantially mm-hmm. reduced.
Right. Yeah.
So your profit margins are exploding. Mm-hmm. So that's a very positive thing. And quite honestly, I don't think we really missed a beat. You kind of panicked in the beginning when you thought, well, we can't have this dinner. it's too dangerous. We thought of the virtual event, and it worked, and people gave even more because of what Nada said. They were concerned that perhaps in this environment, we should give some more money to help them out, given the tough circumstances.
Yeah, I echo much of what Tim said, and I think you go back to the original point, it's such an easy sell, if you will, and I don't want to make it strictly a monetary thing, but the people willing to give to the sisters is just, it's overwhelming at times, and how they're willing to step up and do these things, and then you throw the COVID into it, and now they're even more willing to step up, and it's been an amazing few years here to see how that whole transition from the in-person to the virtual developed. It all in the end relates back to the feeling that everybody has, I don't want to say the obligation, but the respect for the sisters, the respect for everything that they've done, whether it's for these people directly or what they see they do around the world, for that matter. So I think it enables a new age of being able to access everything anytime. It's been a nice, interesting development, if you will, in that regard.
Nada,
yes.
How would you like to tell people listening, watching this, that you all stepped up 9 years ago? John made the calls, and the foundation was formed, and therefore a board. And so, as it evolves and new board members come on, what would you like them to know, that the reason you were able to help them? We talked a little bit about the importance, but that you give of your time for this, all of you. What message would you want other people to know about what it feels like or their need to help the sisters?
I think the sisters have really adapted to the world we live in. And I think we base this in going back to 2013, that's a long time, and there were still many people who had the opportunity to have the sisters as their teachers. And of course that has changed as the schools have changed, but the sisters have continued the mission and adapted it to perhaps fewer numbers, but they've continued that goal of I think inspirational support to all of us. And when I go back, if somebody said to me, where do you think you kind of figured out how you saw yourself in the world? I would say it was in my first grade class. And I've been struggling to find the words, but I feel as though it was a sense of responsibility that was instilled in me. And I'm sure everyone loves their first grade teacher more than life itself, but this was in the time of the missions, when we all gave our nickels every day. Probably it was a dime by the time these guys got there, but it was a nickel when I was there. I never had a feeling other than it was our responsibility. I didn't get the feeling it was all about promoting our religion or converting. I thought it was caring for each other and a tremendous sense of responsibility. And the school I was in had people from really all walks of life and all levels of income. And I remember getting the feeling that you weren't to feel sorry for someone. What you had was just luck or lack of it. And I was taught that people need to be empowered to use whatever gifts they've been given. And that is something that I take from the IHM spirit. And I feel as though members that are coming in, whether we have as many sisters as before or whatever, that message can continue, that we are here for each other. And I guess that's why you would take your time and make sure that we keep that going.
And John, I would assume through all of this and you and your idea and to where it's been, what would you say about that? What would you tell people who want to help, or why they should want to?
Well, I mean, it's more than just Catholic education and all that, as everybody's alluded to. The sisters do so much for so many. that to get involved and come up and volunteer and do what you can. It's funny because as we were talking, and I was sitting here thinking about the first dinner we had, and P.J. Carlissimo, as I said, was our first speaker. Now, P.J.'s traveled the world. He was an NBA basketball coach. He took Seton Hall to the Final Four, to the finals, and then he coached USA basketball. He was an assistant on the Dream Team. He rattled off all eight of his teachers at Immaculate Conception School without even hesitating. He just rattled off all of them. And I was like, that's an impact.
Yeah.
You know, for a guy who could have forgotten all of that, and he just knew it. And he flew in here from San Francisco to be with the sisters to help raise money. So, you know, that kind of says it all.
So, Tim, mm-hmm. in the IHM spirit, your story, your life, how do you feel that you can promote that spirit they have, the IHM way or spirit, in others? What about your life story that you believe is all of the same spirit that these wonderful people have?
I think having the intentionality of giving back to the community and organizations that you feel strongly about. Volunteering and trying to be a compassionate, caring person. And I think that comes across in the different boards that you get involved with in missions. And I think particularly stay in your lane. The sisters always try to bring out the best in us, to try to bring out the best of our talents. So use those talents to an organization where you feel that it could be best served.
And Michael, what do you believe?
That's an easy question, right?
No.
I keep reverting back to this, but not having grown up and gone to school through it, and like these guys have, I've got certainly a different perspective on it, but the lessons, if you will, that I've learned and what I've seen both through my initial involvement through Sister Adrienne, getting to know the sisters through this, and seeing what goes on and what they do, it's kind of funny because you look at it and it's the Sisters of the IHM and it is a religious organization at its core. But when you get to know the sisters and see what kind of people they are, kind of outside of that in a way, I think it's just an amazing, amazing group of women who you have to respect and honor what they do every day. And what everybody you hear all the time, you give back, give back, give back, give back, and all they do is give. And I think when you see what they do, you can learn from that and appreciate that and understand that. And it's a human nature component that you sit there and you just it's awe-inspiring that you're like, wow, just that is just wow. They're amazing. They are. I could go on forever saying these things, and I don't know if you can ever give them enough praise. But all of that reverts back into what doing this means and what you get out of doing it and what you try and tell other people, what it entails, what it involves, what you're doing and why you're doing it, and how that kind of it gets into the spirit of the IHM and that you're going to these other people. And I'm always amazed at the number of people that come up to me as the mailers that go out and our pictures show up in there, and they will say, oh, I saw you you came in, you're in my mailbox today. And the reaction is just, it's great. Because it's not something that you talk about every day necessarily. It's not like you go into the office and like, oh, well, you know, this is going on with the IHM. Mm-hmm. But when they know you've been involved, excuse me, and you are involved, it creates a different kind of a conversation. And it's just really neat to see how it all, again, the IHM spirit. I think that's a great term as to how this how this all comes together in the end, from the board perspective, at least, or being a board member perspective, is just the IHM spirit. It is truly something amazing.
And Nada, I know you spoke a little bit about that in the last question, but could you just give a brief reason as to how you believe your story will help promote the IHM spirit?
I think I've been very fortunate to be a part of so much in our community. And I always say, I think in other areas, this is a little more about our area than it is about the sisters, but I might not have been given the opportunity without much greater financial resources. But I think that, just like when John called, we don't say no, because we always think there is a way. And, you know, I would hope, as people see you get involved, and all different kinds of people with different responsibilities, whether they work from home or don't work at all or are busy raising children, that you can get involved in your community and that we are part of a greater whole and that we all have to participate. But I would hope that's what happens. You know, whenever you are honored, it's embarrassing, and yet you think, maybe it will make someone else believe they should do something too.
So I'm stepping in here to photobomb to
okay.
thank everyone for doing this for all the many years. Even though John looks like he was one of my teachers, he wasn't. He is younger than me. But this,
wow.
at the end of the day, this is my turn. This is a fundraiser, and for all the mission and spirit and great ideas, these people have done a fabulous job, and we're approaching $1 million. But anyone watching who has not made a pledge, we're happy to take your money. And we're going to be doing this, I hope, for a long time. Sister Ann Bubzer has been a wonderful leader for all of us. But I just wanted to jump into this picture before it ended to thank everybody. And just to please make your pledge, make your donation as soon as you can. Thanks.
I'd like to present our awards this evening. The Sisters of IHM Spirit Award recognizes John, Nada, Timmy, and Michael, my dear friends, for commitment to the cherished values and mission of the IHM Sisters. Congratulations, and thank you for all you've done.
Thank you, Sister.
Nada,
thank you. Sister.
And Michael.
Thank you, Sister.
Thank you.
And John.
Thank you, Sister.
God bless you all. You're my friends. Thank you very much for all you've done and how you've grown our organization. Thank you. God bless. Thank you. The IHM congregation needs your help. With 265 sisters and 129 of those sisters who are now over the age of 80, our aging population is growing. The number of younger sisters entering the congregation has decreased through the years. This means that the number of sisters in compensated ministries has changed. The number of sisters participating as volunteers has increased. The IHM sisters devote their lives to their vocation. Some teach, others care for the sick and impoverished. Some establish schools and safe havens for poor communities around the globe. But regardless of their vocation, all sisters serve completely. Each IHM sister takes a vow of poverty. Sisters profess this vow so that they can give of themselves entirely to their ministry. Many of these sisters are aging and now face the reality of needing health care and a gentle place for life to come full circle. This foundation was formed by people like you who want to give back to the sisters who have given so much of themselves. Here are some of the essentials that your kind donations help provide. Health care for our aging sisters. Essential nutrition and daily meals with healthy selections. Our sisters' safety is so important. Non-slip flooring, easy access to all areas, and monitoring necklaces and bracelets are just a few of the ways we keep our sisters safe. Sisters reside at both the IHM Center as well as the Pascucci family, Our Lady of Peace residence. The sisters enjoy safe and pleasant surroundings.
The staff at the IHM Center and our Lady of Peace residents are wonderfully skilled and attentive. Some of the furniture and appliances that the sisters use is either worn or outdated. Lift chairs and hospital beds are heavily used, and some need to be replaced. The sisters do their laundry if they are able, and the washers and dryers need to be in working order. Medical carts are a staple tool at healthcare facilities. Many of our carts are over 15 years old and need to be replaced. If you would like to help the sisters by making a donation, please visit helpihmsisters.com or call us at 570-346-5431. We are also on Facebook. We are so very grateful to each and every one of you. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you, Pat, for all your help and your guidance, your wisdom, and all that you've shared with us. You've been my rock for the last couple of years. Thank you.
Sister, thank you. I've really enjoyed tonight with you and a lot of our friends, Sister Ann. I've heard you put together a slideshow with a rendition of wonderful songs from a popular sister act.
Yes, thank you. I hope you enjoy it.
I don't need a spotlight. I don't need a crowd. I don't need the great white world to shout my name out loud. Don't need fame or fortune, nice as those things are. I've got all I need to feel like I'm a star. I've got my sisters by my side. I've got my sisters' love and pride. And in my sisters' eyes, I recognize the star I want to be. And with my sisters standing strong, I'm on the stage where I belong. And nothing's ever gonna change that fact. I'm part of one terrific sister act. And yes, I love that spotlight. Yes, I crave acclaim. I'll admit I loved the sound when strangers scream my name. All the glitz and glamour, they're all right, no doubt. But what are you left with when the lights go out? Sisters with me still, I'll have my sisters, always will. And with my sisters' love, the star above will shine as bright as me. And as a sister and a friend, I'll be a sister till the end. And no one on this earth can change that fact. I'm part of one terrific sister act. I'll have my sisters with me still. I'll have my sisters, always will. And with my sister's love, the star above will shine as bright as me. And as a sister and a friend, I'll be a sister till the end. and no one on this earth can change that fact. I'm part of one terrific sister act.
Thank you to everyone for watching, listening, and learning about our sisters. You'll always be in our prayers, so send us any special intentions that you have. Thank you again. Good night, and God bless everyone.